Welcome back, everybody. For those of you who don't remember, my name is Frank Lociavo, and I'm the instructor of your class. As we continue to talk about a basic introduction to statistics, this time let's focus on the distinction between descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. In general, statistics can be broken down into two primary branches. Let's talk about each one. Let's talk about descriptive statistics first. As the name implies, our primary goal is to describe our data, to simply start telling the story of our data. And the way we can do that is by organizing our data, summarizing our data, and just in general simplifying it so that we can communicate it in a very effective, easy way to other people. The most obvious way that we can do that is numerically, using numbers, like means, which are just averages, or frequencies or percentages or something like that. Let me give you an example. Imagine that on a college campus there are 1,000 students. And so that we know who those students are, where they're from, who they represent, we're of course going to collect data from them on a variety of measures. And even though I have data from 1,000 people, I can easily boil that data down into some simple descriptive statistics. So here's one example right here. We might find that there are 65% female and 35% male students. Those are simple descriptive statistics. An example of a mean would be an average age. So of all those students, the average age 21.3 years old. That's another example of a basic descriptive statistic. Now, of course, we can describe our data pictorially or visually as well, using charts and graphs. So instead of simply listing that 65% of the students are female and 35% of the students are male, I might decide to show people a pie chart. Of course, that pie would be sliced into two pieces, where one slice represents 65% of the entire pie and the other slice represents 35%. The nice thing about descriptive statistics is that they're flexible, and it's essentially up to the data analyst to describe the best way to tell the story of the data. Let me show you an example on the next page. As we work through this example, you'll better understand the role of statistics in research. In other words, the role of statistics in the scientific process. So imagine that I'm an educational researcher, and I'm interested in comparing two different teaching methods, two different teaching techniques. In my research, I tend to focus on young children. I can't measure all young children, the entire population, so ultimately I'm going to have to collect data from a sample or two. In this case, one sample would be taught by one teaching method, and the second sample would be taught by another teaching method. With the first teaching method, let's assume we're trying to teach some students about math, and in addition to teaching them how to do math by hand, we're also showing them how they can do it using computers. But in the second sample, we're teaching students more traditionally, just teaching them how to do math by hand. Well, of course, we're going to collect a bunch of data. So we're going to teach them using one of those two techniques for a while. And then after that time is up, we're going to test them to see how much they've learned. And the data right here represents their test scores. Just by looking at the scores, it's pretty difficult to figure out what's going on. So we need some procedures to put in place to help organize that data and make sense of it so that we can tell the story of that data. So using basic descriptive statistics, I might try to organize the data using a frequency distribution. And that's what this is right here. It's showing how the different scores are distributed across the number line. In other words, how many students scored 70? How many students scored 71, 72, 73, and so forth? And I can see that there's some variability in the data. Not all the students scored the exact same score. So in addition to creating a frequency distribution, I might also want to compute a simple mean. And in this case, I find out that the mean test score is 76. Well, I can easily compare that data with the data from the second group. We can take all of their exam scores and create another frequency distribution. And using all of those scores, we can easily compute a group mean. And in this case, the average score is 71. So right here, you can see the use of descriptive statistics, whether we're doing it visually, pictorially, using charts and graphs, or whether we're using descriptive statistics numerically, computing something like a mean. And that allows us to take all of this data and then in a relatively simple way tell the story. And at least on the face of it, it looks like the students who were exposed to technology, in addition to hand computations, learned math a little bit more effectively. So those were some good examples of descriptive statistics. And again, the objective is simply to organize our data, summarize our data, and just in general, simplify our data so that we can effectively communicate the results to other people. Descriptive statistics are really pretty straightforward, and we will cover descriptive statistics in our class during the first few weeks. But you're going to find out that we're going to want some statistical procedures that are a little bit more powerful, and that moves us into the realm of inferential statistics. As the name implies, we will use inferential statistics to draw inferences. It's possible that you're not real familiar with that term, so let me just give you an easy example. I assume everybody listening to this video is a student interested in statistics, so I can draw an inference that you're interested in general in education. You are interested in bettering yourself. You're interested in growing as a person. So by examining your behavior, I draw an inference about who you are. Well, inferences come into play when we're talking about statistics as well. And that's because I usually want to learn about an entire population, but I mentioned to you before, they're often so large that I can't measure the entire population. I can only measure a subset of that population, which we call a sample. We want to be able to use that sample data to draw inferences about the population. In other words, when I learn information about a sample, I want to be able to apply that information to the population. So, long story short, inferential statistics help us make accurate inferences about populations based on sample data only. In fact, inferential statistics are going to allow us to estimate population parameters based on sample statistics. Let me give you an example. Remember this population of 1,000 students? If we had access to all of those students and we measured them, we could compute population parameters. So all of these descriptive statistics that you see right here are population parameters. The average age is indeed 21.3. That is the right answer based on all 1,000 students. But we realize in the real world, we can't always measure entire populations. So sometimes we can only measure a sample. Well, here's a sample of 5 students. And if I measured those 5 students, I could then compute some sample statistics. For example, the average age from that sample is 19.8 years old. Do you see how I might want to use that information from that sample to learn about the population that the sample represents? When I see that the average IQ of this sample is 104.6, I want to take that sample statistic and try to learn something about the population parameter. But you'll notice there are only 5 people in this sample. And in fact, I can collect data from another sample of 5 people. But you see, I run into some trouble because each sample has different sample statistics. The average age here is 20.4. The average here is 19.8. If these numbers continually differ, how can I learn about the true average age of the entire population? Well, inferential statistics is going to give us a set of procedures that will allow us to do that. And that's because inferential statistics provides us with methods of dealing with sampling error. Because even when we collect data from a random sample, the sample statistics aren't going to perfectly match the corresponding population parameters. So let's be really clear right here. What exactly is sampling error? Sampling error is the difference that we would expect between a population parameter, like the average age here, 21.3 years old, and a corresponding sample statistic, 19.8 years old. Those numbers aren't the same because sampling error exists. No sample perfectly corresponds to a population. All right, I think I probably just said that 10 different times, but it's an important point, so make sure you think about it and make sure you understand it. Do you see that the existence of sampling error makes things more complicated for us? At the very least, we need to know how much sampling error should we expect. So in other words, we need to be able to measure it. Inferential statistics will provide us with some methods for measuring sampling error. Via inferential statistics, we'll be able to get a good sense of how much error we should expect to find just by chance. Let me give you another example. Remember our students over here? One sample was being taught using one teaching method, and a second sample was being taught using a second teaching method. And we found that these students who were exposed to technology, they outperformed the students who were not exposed to technology. But because sampling error exists, I can't put too much faith in these exact numbers. Because if I expose the entire population of first graders to this first teaching method, I might not find an average test score exactly equal to 76. In fact, I might find an average test score of 75. And if I expose the entire population of first graders to the second teaching method, I might not find an average test score of 71. In fact, I might find an average test score of 72. If I were to measure the entire population of first graders being exposed to technology, I might find that their average test score is equal to 73. And if I took that entire population of first graders and I exposed them to the second teaching method, I might find as well that their average score on a test is 73. In other words, there might be no differences at all. So what we're finding is that because sampling error exists, there are at least two good explanations for the differences that we see right here. One potential explanation is actually very straightforward. The 5-point difference that we see right here in the performance between the two groups actually does represent a real difference between the two teaching methods. This teaching method is superior. But we know that sampling error exists. There might be no differences between these two groups, and the reason why we see the difference that we see right here is simply due to chance variation. Inferential statistics are going to help us decide between those two alternatives. If I could reduce that entire conversation to one sentence, it would probably be this: that inferential statistics will help us make sense of sampling error. And in reality, that's all I want you to know about inferential statistics today. You should just have this vague idea in your mind that inferential statistics will help us make sense of sampling error. All right, well, I think that's enough to cover for right now. In the next video, we'll talk about how we can select between different statistical procedures. In the meantime, let me know if you have any questions and be safe.